Day three is in the wraps. Breakfast with the Cup, the third edition. Let's talk about the games. We have four matchups today. I hope tomorrow we don't have five because I physically can't keep up with this. Let's go with the first matchup of the game. USA versus Vietnam. I know a lot of people walked into this game thinking, oh, this will be USA versus Thailand from 4 years ago. But the U.S. couldn't find their opportunities as much, and the quality chances they were creating weren't as visible. Vietnam certainly, though were on the defensive foot, were able to make things a little bit difficult for the Americans. Only three goals scored for them. Three, really. And I think for the U.S., this is a good start. Sophie Smith getting off the board with two goals. Lindsay Horan with a third. I know there's an Alex Morgan penalty that saved there. But ultimately, I think the kids got out and played. Trinity Rodman had a very good game. I know she won't get as much of the attention because you see players like Sophia Smith with two goals. You see Megan Rapinoe getting into the game, missing an opportunity. But I think Trini Rodman had a very nice game out on the wing for the U.S. And I think this team should grow. I still think they are not their full potential yet. I don't think it'll be this year. I think the next World Cup or even the Olympics will see a better version of this squad moving into it. But I think as it stands now, I think this U.S. team, a good start, good dominating win. I don't know if you're going to see necessarily as many of the lopsided games as we've seen in past World Cups. I think it'll be a very much more so, just a lot of dominant games, but tighter score lines. So for the U.S., that's there. For Vietnam, I think if they can get another team that's not as dominant with the ball, we'll see what they're able to do, to see if they can create some more on the counter. But against this U.S. team, you didn't have many options moving forward for that. So no real surprise, but still looking good for the squad. Another team I'm very much curious to see how well they'll do is... We move on to the next game. Now, Zambia was my vibes team. I mean, they have a great theme for their team. I've been vibing to that the last few days. And then they played Japan. And I said this in my show, and I'll say it here. Reports of their demise have been greatly exaggerated. Yes, they're in a transition, but don't ever think that that style of play doesn't transition from level to level. This, you may look at the possession numbers in this game, and you'll think, okay, so you know maybe Zambia had a few opportunities. Japan was not giving Zambia the space that they've had in the past. No teams were really spaced off, and the ball was getting won in the midfield, second balls were being won. The passes were tight and crisp. The ball was getting moved. And though this game ends 5-0, this game could have been far, far worse. I think Japan thoroughly dominated this game. And if not for, you know, a few offsides, they could have won this game by a wider margin and a wider score. So Japan definitely sending a message to the rest of the field saying, yes, I know a lot of you think you could win this. But don't forget us. Do not forget us. We will not be ignored. We will not be forgotten. So please, oh please, don't forget that we are a thing. And we're coming for our respect. And we're coming to win. And to play well and represent well. So I don't think anyone should be sleeping on Japan. Though they are in that transition, this Japan side is still a solid side, and I think they can truly give a lot of challenges to the team that they're playing. So with Japan coming in, I mean, you had a few goals that were brought off. The goal scores for Japan in this game, I just had them for a minute and then I lost it. So yeah, the goal scores for Japan, you had the 43rd minute, Hinata Miyazawa in the 43rd and the 62nd minute, Mina Tanaka in the 55th minute, Jun Undo in the 71st minute, and then Riko Ueki. If I said that wrong, guys, I'm struggling, but I don't mind the corrections. With a penalty in the 101st minute, the 11th minute of additional time this game. Zambia's goalkeeper was sent off with two yellows, so Zambia's going to be playing with their next best keeper. And that'll be very interesting to kind of watch to see how they have to adjust with that. But Japan in their 3-4-3 really took it to and took away the space that this Zambia team, the Copper Queens, tried to play with, and they weren't really able to do so. So all credit to Japan. I think the big game everyone's going to be talking about today is England versus Haiti. And when I say England survived Haiti, I say it. I was having this conversation earlier. I think one of the things that makes this World Cup more similar, I'd say, to some of those early men's World Cups is that you don't necessarily have the same scouting that teams would have. You know, if you think back to the early men's World Cup where you have most of the teams playing in their local leagues, or maybe they're not as well-known or scouted, every region really knowing, and even more so, more countries only really knowing their players. When you get to these world stages, you find players that you think, oh, this player is, or this team is a different style. And you saw those advantages come with like teams like Brazil, who had mainly local players and were able to do this. Now, in the world game now, and the women's game is getting there, but in the world game now, most players are known, most players are playing in top leagues, and because of that, now you're just seeing, oh, there's a familiarity with players. Also, there's a bit of a synchronism with styles, right? And different leagues have different ways of playing, therefore, stylistically, players' strengths and weaknesses are there. But I think people outside of CONCACAF looked at Haiti and said, well, it's Haiti. We look at their GDP. We look at what they do. This should be an easy walk for one of the hottest national teams in the world. And they survived this team. Now, for those of you who aren't aware, allow me to reintroduce you to Melchie Dumernay, or Corventina, as we call her here in CONCACAF. I think she's on their way of being one of the best players in the world. There's a nice crop of next young players, from the Linda Caicedos, the Selma Porielas, Melchie Dumernay. I think there's a trio of players who are coming who are going to really take over, be that next faces, those next new faces of the game internationally. And Dumernay is one of them. That being said, My questions with Haiti coming into this tournament were not how good would they be. It'd be how much they would give up, because Haiti have been a team, regardless of the competition they played, and even against England, for those who were surprised to see it, they create opportunities. They create great opportunities. They just cannot finish. And it's not even saying that, oh, they struggle in the third. No, they can't finish. The chances that this team will create, they're going to create chances in every game they play, because the ability of their midfield to carry, the ability of starting Dumernay up top or in that 10 role to drop down between Pierre-Louis and Judy and then take the ball and give players like Kira Walsh, Ella Toon, Georgie Stanley, who got the goal for England, give them problems because the pace that they can carry it with. They have speed. And not like the Nana Fast team, this Haiti team has speed. But if their speed was as good as their finishing, this team would be in a different category. But that's where the problem is. I don't think this team can finish consistently. Now, they'll probably have a game in this World Cup where all of a sudden they'll put five, right? You could see maybe it's against Denmark, maybe it's against China. This team will have a game where all of a sudden it clicks and then they're going to bag all the goals. And then the next game, they'll just hit nothing but posts. Their consistency, I think that's the thing. It's a young team. Some of their older veterans, I think, sometimes let them down. Borgella, I know she gives up the penalty. But I'm telling you, this squad, if they had as much quality finishing as they had speed, this team would be far more dangerous. But I think they've shown well here. This team is certainly going to cause the rest of the group, China and Denmark, some problems. As for England, they didn't play a great game, but they got the job done. They get the penalty, but I would love to see England do a better job of putting teams away. Now, granted, this is a Haiti team that, for me, is all vibes and good times, but I think this England team has to do a better job of putting teams away. Shout out to Jill Carter, Jess Carter, my apologies, not Jill. Shout out to Jess Carter, who defensively on those counters, I think was a piece that made it difficult for Haiti to get even more opportunities. Her defensive tackling, her defensive positioning, Jess Carter really put in a shift for the three Lionesses. So England gets the three, they move up to the top of their group, and they look good. Lastly, let's talk about Denmark and China. Amelia Vandegaard in the 89th minute gets the set-piece goal that gives Denmark a vital 3 points in this game. This game was far more even than even the stats sometimes give it credit for. What I find interesting about this game is, why is Denmark playing Pernille Harder as a 9 when I think she's a much better 10? Like, if you're going to play a 4-3-3, drop her between that and actually put a striker up there. I think unless you want her to stop by, then you play a 4-4-2 diamond in that sense. Because I feel that you get more of her strengths when you get more 9s playing, right? You play on Amelia Vandegaard. Sorry, apologies, guys. But I think that's the type of player where if you get them playing further up the pitch as a 9, then you drop off Pernille Harder as that 10. I think that bodes well better for the squad. And if not, then you're really making it a lot more difficult than it has to be. I do like what they've done so far. I like that they were able to battle through and get this goal. Also, interesting fact, this game is the first game out of all the matches that didn't have a penalty, and there was a clear penalty that wasn't given. You can't half dribble the ball and then not call it a penalty. I'm sorry. But that being said, I just like that Denmark was able to get the victory. They fought through, they struggled through, got it at the depth. I saw someone on Twitter say Denmark is just a less frustrating Norway. Maybe that's the case. But this World Cup, I think that's another thing that I'll say about this World Cup. The teams I thought would get blown out, though they were dominated, get the score lines low. I don't think there is really that many blowouts in this tournament, if anything. Again, Japan got their 5 and really should have been 7 or 8 against Zambia. But I am saying this is going to be a more tightly contested World Cup than I think we're used to. With 32 teams and coaches of the level, and you say this at every World Cup, you can't hide. Everyone knows your strengths and everyone knows your weaknesses. So now it's just a matter of, can coaches exploit, and furthermore, can coaches adjust? Can they counter properly to what's been taken away? Or can they counter to the opportunity that's given to them? Guys, this has been Breakfast with the Cup, Day 3 edition. Guys, let me know in the comments, what do you think about these 4 games today? Who surprised you? I anticipate a lot of Haiti comments. But who surprised you today? Who disappointed you? Guys, let me know in the comments. We'll wrap it up from there.